Are we ready to start?
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening.
Yeah.
So today we are at the third class. We are at on midway to our this first module, and I would say that the lesson of today is in a way a summary or a clarification of what we have done so far, trying to develop a concept that will explode in the next class when we will talk about entrepreneurship. We are not yet there. The next one, I think, will be quite exciting to discuss what actually is the role of an entrepreneur and how can we define entrepreneur. But before going there, we need to clarify certain points that we have seen up to now, and in particular to clarify how what we have seen so far help us to define in a certain way the concept of market and the concept of competition, which are concepts that I believe are not treated in the proper way in the traditional teaching of economics. So this class probably will be also shorter compared to the previous ones. Okay, the second one we overflow with the timing and the questions. Today maybe we will keep it a little bit shorter. I am also a little bit tired compared to the past. I just back from Sunday from 1 week in Bangladesh, which was not easy, and after that I started a week of corporate meetings with the MDs and all these kind of things. I'm also overstressed by corporate burdens, I would say. So let's make it easy for everybody. But the right way to start is to give you some of the definitions of perfect competition that you find on the textbooks. If you are going to study economics in most of the universities nowadays, you will find one of these definitions, and competition, perfect competition, what they define as perfect competition, will have certain features that I will go to list in a while. Okay? So if you take an example, Varian, which is one of the most famous textbooks in economics, you will read that the perfect competition is the situation prevailing in a market in which buyers and sellers are so numerous and well informed that all elements of monopoly are absent, and the market price of a commodity is beyond the control of individual buyers and sellers. This is one of the definitions that you can find on the textbooks. Okay? You can Google these things and you will find a lot of very similar definitions. So the situation prevailing, and this is already a problem, as we will see in a while. The situation prevailing in a market. So perfect competition is, according to the textbook, a situation prevailing at a certain point. So you understand that competition is defined as an arrival point, as a state of affair, when, as we will see in a while, probably is much more appropriate to define competition as the process that lead toward the state of affairs rather than the state of affairs itself. Okay? And this is the first point that we will go to describe in a while. Another definition very similar. Perfect competition is the theoretical condition of a market where prices reflect complete mobility of resources and freedom of entry and access, full access to information by all participants, relatively homogeneous products, and the fact that no one buyer or seller or group of buyers or sellers has any advantage over another. This is another definition commonly found about perfect competition. So if we had to summarize how the traditional teaching of economics define perfect competition, we should look at these three points. A homogeneous commodity offered and demanded by a large number of relatively small sellers or buyers, none of whom expects to exercise by his action a perceptible influence on price. Second, free entry into the market and absence of other restraints on the movement of prices and resources. And third point, complete knowledge of the relevant factors on the part of all participants in the market. So, again, the first point that we should criticize about this approach is that, in a way, perfect competition is described as a state of affairs, like a snapshot, okay, of a situation prevailing in a certain market in a certain moment. Is this clear? But it's like to say that when you are watching a soccer match or a boxing match or a basketball match, whatever sport competition, the perfect competition is the result of that match. So when you have Manchester United against Manchester City, competition is the final result, which is perfectly described already by the conditions that are here. If we apply this model of competition to a soccer match, we have the result already defined, and the result most probably will be nil to nil, because none of the opponents can actually have an influence on the outcome. The outcome is already described in the conditions, and the condition is that nobody is able to discriminate on things and on price. In a case, on the case of a soccer match, is able to discriminate on the actual process of the match. So the final result is already there. The soccer players has a perfect knowledge on how all the other players will actually react to any determined actions, and therefore, what is missing in this match? The match itself. The match you can play for 90 minutes or even for 3 days, and everything is perfectly combined. Okay, one player is moving the ball in a certain way, the other player will react in a certain way, but everybody is acting and reacting in a way in which the result anyway cannot be modified. So if you look at the match at the beginning, nil-nil, without any action happening, or at the end of the soccer match, nil-nil, after many action happen, but without any real effect on the final result, there is no difference. So, at the end of the match, you are looking at a snapshot that was already totally deductible from the conditions, from the initial conditions. Okay? But for the ones among you that ever looked at the sport competitions, know that this is not what is actually happening. Right? Can we define a perfect competition in soccer, a competition in which the result is basically already there and nobody is able to discriminate on the outcome of the match by doing something? Is this a competition or is nothing at all. You are with me? You got the point? You have a question?
Not yet.
Not yet. So try to apply, I think that if you apply this vision to a sport match, you understand that defining competition as the textbooks are actually defining it, you are basically taking out from competition, competition. So if you take out from competition, competition, what is left? Nothing, right? So the first big mistake in the theoretical approach toward competition is that you take out the process of competition itself, which by nature is dynamic. If we could if we could have in mind the outcome of a soccer match before the soccer match happened, we were all winning at the betting game, but indeed there would be no price for betting because there is no uncertainty, and the reward on betting is based on the fact that you are guessing on an uncertain outcome. So your entrepreneurial skill when you bet is to have a better understanding of the potential outcome of a soccer match. So you are winning exactly because you have better knowledge, maybe by luck only, of what might happen, right? And if we are looking at the soccer match itself, why a team is actually winning against another? Or because they have a better player? Or because they are better as a team, or because they are simply lucky and the other team had a bad mood, bad moment, or because of the trainer, the coach, the manager, or because they bribed the referee. Also that can happen and regularly happens, right? Or just luck. Most of the outcome of our daily routine is based on luck, often, right? So, what we miss by defining competition as the textbook defines perfect competition, we are taking out a process, okay, which is the real essence of competition. Okay, and where this process is actually happening? In the market. The market is that place in which the process of competing is actually taking shape. If you are talking about a soccer match, we have a soccer field, okay? So it's very easy to identify. When we are going into the analysis of the economic system, the field is much bigger. The market is not simply the market in the sense of the bazaar, okay? The physical place where some economic transactions are actually happening. The bazaar, of course, is a possibility, but indeed, every single place is potentially a market. Whenever there is a transaction between human beings, there is a market. Okay? But as you can realize from the discussion that we had in the past weeks and we are having now, market is not a state of affairs. It's not an outcome, something that come out from certain pre-described conditions, is indeed the unfolding of that process. And that's why, according to the Austrian School of Economics, market is indeed a process. And therefore, the typical instruments of the static analysis cannot be applied to something that is by nature dynamic, and which, as we have seen last time, unfold thanks to the dynamic element par essence, that is what we talked about last time. What was the most important thing that we discussed last time?
Time.
Time. Can we imagine a process, the unfolding of the dynamic process without time? No. There is no action without time. Time is the essential dimension where the market process actually happens, bringing together novelty, as we have seen last time. New information is acquired and exchanged only via time. And there here we come to point three of the discussion that of the description that we have seen before. Complete knowledge of the relevant factors on the part of all participants in the market. Again, let's go to the soccer match again. Can we imagine a match in which the two teams, the 22 players, have perfect knowledge of all the relevant factors implying in the match itself? Can we imagine that? No. Otherwise, it would be very boring. Not only for us watching, but also for the players playing. There would be no excitement, no real fighting, because you already know what's going to happen any moment. And therefore, your action becomes simply a reaction, but not a human reaction. Rather, a robotic reaction. Robot is that entity that automatically react to a given set of inputs. Okay? So there is no fantasy into the way in which robot complete their tasks. In advance, we know what is going to happen. Okay? That's why we have automation in factories. We have automation because we know that certain processes can actually be standardized. So we want a consistent reaction in front of certain actions, right? So we want the machines to behave always in the same way in front of certain input, because we want standardized products. If we would not have this, we would have a differentiated production. That was what was going on before the Industrial Revolution, before the automation of processes, right? So every pair of shoes before the Industrial Revolution was actually unique, because a certain man producing shoes was not able to do more things in the same way. There was always a certain novelty brought in by the human factor. But with automation, we can create standardization. But when we talk about human response to inputs, then we enter the infinite world of uncertainty. There is no given reaction to certain action. Okay? And that's why it's not possible to know the outcome of a market transaction or a market process in advance, because we are not robots. Okay? And that's why we don't have only one model of shoes into the shopping malls. Ladies want to be differentiated when they go to a party. They get mad if they are using the same shoes that their friend are using, right? Oh my God, the same shoes. I need better kakiaya maja rather than having the same shoes, right? They want to get something different, because it's the way in which they personalize their reaction to a certain party. This is very important. And when we look at a world in which products are homogeneous and in the market you can find only a certain kind of product with a certain given price, I don't know if you are familiar with the Soviet Union, what was going on under USSR before the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, that was actually what was happening. We had the production that was decided by the government. So all the shoes factory were producing a certain kind of shoes. Everybody was wearing the same. There was no differentiation of products. The price was given by government. The salary of all the people was given by government, was decided by government. Okay? And therefore, in our theoretical education about economics, we have the paradox that economists, by describing what they define as perfect competition, they are actually describing the perfect socialism. Okay? Homogeneous commodity. Is this the outcome of competition? No. This is the perfect outcome of socialism. Everybody is wearing the same clothes. Okay? Nobody can expect to exercise influence on price. Is this competition? No. There is market here. It's a fiction. A market in which there is no discrimination on price and on products is not a market. It's simply not a market. It's a fiction. Okay? And this actually happened in history. We had extreme cases on this situation, but this didn't happen in competitive markets, in countries embracing at least partially the competitive nature of human action. This happened under socialism.
I think agriculture for this looks like perfect competitions. For example, fruits or vegetables in this certain area, the product is homogeneous and the price is determined by the markets. This is the example of...
What does it mean? This is a problem. What does it mean, the price is determined by the market?
The price determined by the markets means that if the price is not influenced by the others, so the market determines the price.
Who are the others? Who are the others and who is the market?
The market is the center of where the people
meet
to buy something.
Okay. Yeah. So, but the market exists itself.
How
price is determined in this case?
When the product is homogeneous, and the price will be at a certain level.
Yeah, but how?
The price is
determined
by how?
Okay, and I can agree at a certain extent that in the commodities price is
determined by the market.
Always price is determined by the market.
Yeah.
Okay, so we are not contesting the fact that price is the outcome of the market, but what I'm contesting is how we define the market and the process of determining prices.
Process of determining of price.
Yes.
How the market determine the price, you mean?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking you. What does it mean that the price is given by the market?
When the supply and demand is equilibrium, when there are supply and the demands there, so that the equilibrium and the price will be determined.
So, this is what happened always. Not only in the commodity market. Okay? This has to be clear And we will see, I think the last class of this course is about the interaction between supply and demand and price theory. And we will see this in details also with some graphs. But the central point is here, that I'm making here, is not that somewhere else prices are not determined by the market. Except from socialism, prices are indeed determined by the market. But the issue is here how we determine the market. What you are trying to say, so you don't have to distinguish between perfect and imperfect competition in this sense. Rather, I would say if there is competition or there is no competition, I'm not concerned about the level of perfection of competition, because this is like a masturbation, okay, in a sense. Is not the point, because competition in the sense in which is described by the textbooks is a fiction, doesn't exist, and it's not even competition. There is no competition. The point that you are making is that in a market in which product is homogeneous by nature, there is less margin for suppliers or demanders to discriminate on price. But doesn't mean that it's not supply and demand that are deciding on price. Still, is supply and demand deciding on prices, okay? Still is the case. But the margin for introducing a way to discriminate on your product is very low. We take the example of shoes, okay? We have different prices for different kind of shoes in the market, okay? Because the entrepreneurial action, one side, that we will see next class, and consumer tastes on the other side play a bigger role, because people can have different tastes. I like formal shoes, I like sporty shoes, I prefer cheap, I prefer expensive, I prefer to look nice, because I'm Italian, so I always need to use a certain kind of shoes. Or here I'm in Malaysia, everybody's just going flip-flop will be enough. Or someone else, from the producer side, the producer can invest on marketing, on emotions, okay? Or if you wear my shoes, you are like Brad Pitt, because Brad Pitt is using my shoes, okay? Or can place on a better material. I'm using real leather, where the leather was taken out by the cow, by a woman in Mongolia skinning the cow, so this leather is very precious. So there is the possibility for the demand side and the supply side to interact and discriminate in a way in which we can have very different outcomes. Okay, because not everybody wants to have the same pair of shoes. When we talk about a product of nature, rice is rice, okay? And also there is not true, because we know that we have different varieties, different countries of origins. But in a certain moment, the power of discriminating on that is less. Not because supply and demands are not playing, not because this is a perfect competition, but because of the nature of the product. The human intervention there is more limited. But also here, also on the commodity price, you can see that more and more there is consumer consciousness. And because there is consumer consciousness, there is the possibility for producers to discriminate more. Like now, in the agriculture, there is the fashion of biological. Okay? You know all these things about biological. Grow chicken in the open field rather than in battery. Or grow rice respecting certain standards. there are no scientific evidences, in example talking about the chicken market, the poultry market, that chicken that are raised in open field are more happy compared with chicken that are living in a battery situation. There are no scientific evidences. But thanks to a certain entrepreneurial action, which is, hey, you know, we have to respect the animals. If you treat the animals in a certain way, the meat that you eat is respecting your colon and your stomach better, and therefore you will be more healthy. You are more healthy, and the chicken is more happy. But in the end, it's always dead. The final outcome is that the chicken is slaughtered. But this is a way in which entrepreneur can charge you more for a chicken which is exactly the same or even more insane because spend his time walking on his shit, which is the reality, and because find a way to make you more convinced that the chicken raised in a certain way are more healthy for you. Okay? So a market that was rather uniform in quality and price is getting more variable. So now you have Kampung chicken, you have battery chicken, a certain level, because of different perception about eating and animal welfare that come out from lot of marketing, a lot of research, a lot of new disease, a perception both from consumer side and producer side that are interacting, and therefore now not all chicken are the same. So even in the commodity market, which was quite a uniform market, there are growing spaces for discrimination. So that market that was resembling more the theoretical conditions of the so-called perfect competition is becoming, thanks God, less perfect, which means there is more room for consumers and producers to intervene in a way and ask different things. And if consumers are asking different things, yeah, the producer come here and they tell you that their chicken are very happy because they walk around, and therefore to reach the 2 kilos weight, it takes 45 days instead of 30 days, and therefore you have to pay for that 15 days more. And you will be happy, yes, because I respect animals. I love chicken. I want them to be happy. And I want to eat chicken, meat coming from happy chicken. So now you are laughing, because these things in this part of the world are not yet so developed. But if you go to Holland, people are crazy for these things and are paying 3-4 times the price for chicken if it is a happy chicken, full of shit because he spent his time walking around in an open farm, but very happy. According to scientific evidences, no, according to green people, but green people are affecting the way in which normal people think. So our task as an economist is not to say green people are telling the truth or are telling bullshit, or you are smart or stupid in paying more for happy chicken. Our task as an economist is simply to realize that there is competition there. There is more competition because tastes are changing. Expectations are changing. Expectations are changing because health conditions and health consciousness are changing. And health consciousness and tastes are changing because people are richer. Yeah.
So for
the
market's competitions, because you said that the Holland, right? The country that's consumed with a healthy chicken,
yeah,
because they are developed country,
yes,
they are more consumed on the luxury.
Of course, this is because the income is higher, and therefore you can get concerned with other kind of things that I think the farmer, the poor farmer in Vietnam, maybe is not really concerned. He's more concerned to have, anyway, some chicken. This is true, but this is a different type of market that simply, my point was that even in markets, the commodity markets, which we think are more standardized, in certain conditions, the standardization can change. And this is the beautiful thing of the market, that people can be fooled by the green people. And this is but our task again as an economist is to take note of that, to check what's going on in that market, why it's changing. We realize preferences and tastes are changing, and this means social change and the product of market interactions. Okay, and even on that, government intervention can eventually stop that, because at a certain point in Europe, in example, the government arrived to say that traditional way, means battery way to raise chicken, is no more allowed. Okay, so you don't find anymore in the market the unhappy chicken. What does it mean? This means that because of government action, tastes are oriented and poor people are punished, because the happy chicken is much more expensive than that. And what is the final product of government action forcing you to buy happy chicken? Is that everybody is paying more, because when you cut out by law the competition from the unhappy chicken, you are taking out of the market the cheap product. So who is suffering of that? The lowest classes of the population. You are concerned about health, but if people are poor and they cannot afford certain kind of products, they can be very healthy, but they starve. Okay? So this is the situation in which also government, but this is part of a wider discussion in which is better not to go in. Now we will go in that in the future. I was going to the point 3 of the description, which is complete knowledge of the relevant factors. Again, in a competitive market, if you think, and we will see this better when we will talk about the entrepreneurs, the competition happens and the market process can actually start rightly because there is no complete knowledge. If there was complete knowledge of the factors, we would not need action. We would not need entrepreneurs. Is the entrepreneur that in a way can make you conscious of certain health issues and therefore try to sell you a happy chicken at a higher price by selling you the story of having a healthier colon? Okay? But if the knowledge of the consumer was already perfect in advance, there would not be need for this discrimination action. And the competitive nature of the market lies precisely in the fact that not everybody is doing the same thing. Here, I brought to you tonight an entrepreneur. So we have a live case, but to be more adequate for the next class, but he will not be in Malaysia in 2 weeks. So,
I'm here as his friend.
Yes. But he's also an entrepreneur, a successful entrepreneur, generations. You are selling, he's selling fans for agricultural purposes. He's producing and selling ventilation system for agricultural purposes. You know, in the agriculture industry, indeed, fans are quite a commodity in the sense that there is a certain level of standardization. But, and this I want to hear your witnessing, why eventually a customer is buying your fans rather than buying other European fans or Chinese fans or Japanese fans? If you had to bring your simple witnessing, why do you win sales contracts?
Simply, we try to make it as best as we can at the best price. Let's say, try to have a product that is added value for the money you buy. So that is the main reason. So to have something different from others. Something that
you said one thing. You try to have something different from different others.
And better for our case, but can also be different and cheaper, only maybe different. But that is all. Another reason why the European product must be better than others, because we have internal cost in the countries, we cannot develop things that are cheap. So the only way is for better quality. That is one must, because the market is going that way, and then if you go for cheap things, you have no space, so you look for something better. So then what you have to do in a way that is also competitive.
But he said something that is very crucial, and I want to start from there. He's competing in the market because he's trying to do something different, which is exactly the opposite of the definition of homogeneous products. So he is into the competitive arena, which is the market process, because of the attempt to do something different. That can be on the quality of products, can be on the production process, can be even in the choice of salesperson. You cannot imagine how different can be the outcome of a negotiation because of a certain person. The company where I work was totally unsuccessful in a certain market for many years. In the moment in which they replaced the salesperson, they became number one in that market. So doing the same identical things with the same identical price, approaching the same identical customers, but you change the person, your ambassador of that product, and your competitive position, which is dynamic, so you brought in a differentiation, become successful.
But sometimes the same product, better communicated to the market, it can enter to the market much better than the other one. That is another added value. People knows how to buy from you, knows how to do the second service. Communication.
Marketing. Sometimes communication can be even a trick. We are not here discussing the honesty of the entrepreneurial communication. Can be also a trick. We know salespeople that in order, and here our friend he told last time that he interact with suppliers that became his suppliers because they promise a certain delivery date that they couldn't actually honor. So they trust them, they perceived an added value. Again, based on difference, this supplier is able to send me the products faster than other supplier, so they win, not because they are doing the same things as others, but rightly because there is a differentiation, in this case lead time, but the lead time that was promised was a fake. It was an Italian supplier, by the way.
Blacklist.
So, of course, probably they will not go anymore to this supplier, they will change, but in a way that supplier won the competitive process in a certain moment because he tried to differentiate. I will be faster than the others. Then again, because of what we have seen in the past two classes, between the choice of a plan and all the implementation in time of the plan, many things can be discovered. So what was discovered by our friend? Our friend discovered that that supplier is not reliable. He's promising something that creates a competitive advantage in the very short run, but is not able to keep on promises. And therefore, maybe they were thinking to produce many things using that suppliers, but now they are going to revise their plan and going on to check on another supplier, not because another supplier do the same things, but rightly because another supplier possibly will do a different things. So I'm stressing on all these examples to make you perceive how the competitive nature of the market is not based on homogeneity and perfect knowledge, but rather is based on imperfect knowledge, limited knowledge, and on differentiation. This is the key point. Without differentiation, we would not have market.
So, perfect market is not existing yet?
Again, as Hayek states...
Theory of economy, but
in reality, I want to quote you this passage of Hayek because it's rather explicative of what I have in mind.
So we can conclude that there is no perfect competition?
If by perfect competition we take the definition of the textbook, that is not competition at all. Not only is perfect, it's not competition. So why I should describe competition in a way that doesn't represent what the normal people have in mind as competition? So Hayek is saying here, is one of the readings that were suggested, I don't know if among the fundamentals or among the additional ones, so I don't know if you have in the file or printed, but anyway, the practical lesson of all these, I think, is that we should worry much less about whether competition in a given case is perfect and worry much more whether there is competition at all. So the discrimination in a market is between competition and non-competition rather than between perfect competition and non-perfect competition. Because the word itself, competition, suggests the basic idea that competition exists if there is imperfection. Imperfection in the sense of differentiation. Because if we would not have that, we are putting a label, competition, on something that is not competition. It's like to give you a different name. Your name is?
Harizam.
Harizam. So, if I say the perfect Harizam is that person is a person which is 2 meters tall, blonde, and wearing a white shirt. Is that a reason? I can decide by regulation, by convention, that this is a reason, but if I take the real reason, it doesn't match. So, here the case is even different. Now I will introduce something that probably you are not familiar with. So try to follow me. We put a little bit of pepper in this discussion. Introducing an unexpected thing. I didn't plan to talk about this, but the conversation is driving to the master of all the masters, Plato. Plato. Plato, chi era costui? Who was this man? You know what Plato, you know first who Plato was?
Greek philosopher.
A Greek philosopher living between the 5th and the 4th century before Christ. So, quite long time ago. Like my students write on their exams, Plato lived somewhere before Christ, which means very long ago. This is what I read sometime in the exams, so it's a bit frustrating, but they have the idea that was a long time ago. Plato means fatty. This was not his real name, was a nickname that his gym teacher gave to him. So you see, this man became famous with a nickname meaning fatty. And all over the world, with the most important philosopher of mankind, the inventor of all the human categories, is known to be called fatty. So our brain, our way to think, is based on the ideas of fatty. So Plato had, to make it very simple, someone here study Plato in school? No, yeah?
I can't remember.
No, at least if you ever heard the name in school, I don't ask you to go into deep the discussion between Plato and Aristotle. But someone even said that all the history of philosophy can be described as a comment on Plato. So basically, philosophy is Plato, all the rest is just a comment on Plato. So 3,000 years of history of thought is just a comment on Plato. This just to give you the idea of the importance, at least for the Western thought, that Plato had. And it's true, Plato is always with us, in a way, in the Western world mostly. Plato had this idea of distinguishing between how the things actually are and the ideal concept. So, to make it simple, there are horses, okay? You all can see different kind of horses, you know, small, big, black, brown, white. But none of them is the horse. Okay? They are horses because of certain common features. Okay? Four legs, a certain kind of hair, etc., etc. But none of them is the ideal horse. But in the mind of God, there was the perfect idea of the horse, okay? And all the earthly things are simply an approximation of that ideal, okay? What was called later on the ideal type. Who said type? You? Who said type? Nobody, I just dreamt that someone was aware about this. Sometimes, you know, we teachers have a lot of expectations and we get happy with leaders. Someone say type, I don't hear. So the ideal type. Okay? The idea of horse and all the real horses are approximation of that. So the task of the philosopher, the person that is already at a certain level of knowledge, is the possibility to understand the ideal, to see the ideal, to get in touch with the ideal, with the world of the ideas. we are here at ideas, so it matched quite well. Okay. And he had a big conflict with his best student, Aristotle, about this. Aristotle didn't believe in the ideas. There are horses. We can see these horses. This horse one, horse two, they are all different, indeed. And most of our economics, the economics that I explained to you, is quite Aristotelic. But there is no such a thing as the idea horse. It doesn't exist. Okay? It's just an invention, but there is no usefulness in identifying this. Because in the reality, we have to deal with the real horses. Okay? And Aristotle defined a lot of important categories for the development of science. Indeed. So, in a way, why I came to all this, why I came to Fetti, to Plato? Because we might say that the attempt to define perfect competition done by mainstream economists can be seen as the attempt to arrive at the ideal type of competition. So like the idea to identify the Platonic perspective of competition. But why it is not even a Platonic approach? These people didn't understand anything about Plato.
Sorry, I'm
because
my question.
Yeah.
Why do we have to accept the Plato concept? Why do we have to accept it?
No, in fact I'm telling you that most of my economics is Aristotelic, so it's not Platonic at all. But so I'm not asking you, but anyway. We should go more into this, but the idea is that even if we follow an Aristotelic approach, okay, and we might say that the attempt of certain mainstream economics is to be Platonic, what I'm trying to say here is that they are even not Platonic, because if we apply the Platonic concept here, you say there are many different kinds of competitions, then there is the perfect competition. Okay. But of course, when you are going to define the essence of competition, you should look at how at the real competition. So when Plato has in mind the ideal horse, he's not denying the actual horses. Is taking from them something and trying to go to the essence of horse in order to define the ideal horse. So if we want to be Platonic, we should look at competitive processes and try to take the essence of the competitive process. What is common, what is ideal? In this definition, the definition that I criticize so far, the essence itself of competition is denied. Because when you take out from competition the differentiation, when you introduce perfect knowledge, you are putting in elements that are exactly the denial of competition. So, in the Platonic attempt to define an ideal type of competition, economists are introducing the perfect concept of socialism. So the Platonic idea that they have in mind is the denying of the nature. So they are, that's why I'm saying they are even not good Platonists. Even if I claim to be Aristotelic in my approach, but if I want to force myself to be Platonic and to find the perfect concept of competition, I should look at the essence of the competitive process to arrive at this definition. and the essence is based on imperfection and differentiation. Because this is not an additional element of the competitive process, but the very nature of the competitive process. Taking out differentiation, discrimination, and imperfection of knowledge, we are describing exactly the opposite. So if you take this definition and instead of calling it perfect competition, you call it perfect socialism, then you are, you define the essence of socialism. So we should take this label and apply it exactly at the contrary.
So okay? A Platonic understanding assumes that such a thing is an ideal competition, but ideal competition by itself requires imperfect conditions.
Of course.
So it's a paradox, I guess.
It's quite a paradox, but if the nature of something is the imperfect nature, and we want to describe its nature, we cannot deny its nature by making something imperfect as perfect. So I can, again, I can understand this because periodically we have Platonic resurgences in the evolution of human thought, but it's very dangerous. Okay, you should read this point, but this is for the people among you that like a little bit of adventure. Sir Karl Popper. Should read also Marx. Marx was a real Platonist.
If you talk about Marx, you are.
I have actually, if I have to be honest, I have quite a sympathy for Marx, in the sense that I don't agree with his conclusions, but I recognize him as a good economist with good intuitions, much better than most of the Marxists later.
Yes,
that's the issue. So you should.
Perfect, but
doesn't work. But there are a lot of fallacies. But he was a good scholar. Was a very bad human being. He made for pursuing his dreams. He was having his family starving. He made pregnant his maid, and then kick her out. And so he lived as a parasite with the money of his friend Engels, that was the son of an entrepreneur. So he was writing books against the market with the money of an entrepreneur. So he was a bad human being. Even Einstein was a bad human being, but we don't judge the greatness of scientists by their personal life. Like, you know, now we have all these discussions about these actors involved with sexual scandals and everything is the same. I don't judge the greatness of an actor on his personal life. He can be a son of a bitch, but if he's a good actor, he's a good actor. We should distinguish, no? You don't know anything about my personal life. Who you know if I'm a Sicilian mafioso that yesterday just ordered a killing of someone? Still, I'm a good teacher. Karl Popper, the open society and its enemies. Read it. Should be something like 800 pages, but it'll keep you busy for quite some time during the Christmas holidays. But first you should read Plato and Aristotle, because if you read this without having read Plato and Aristotle, you don't understand anything. It's a basic fact. So we got a little bit lost, I think, in the explanation introducing Plato. But the point is, if we want really to give an essential definition of something, we cannot deny its own very nature. And the very nature of competition is to be based on imperfections, imperfect knowledge, and discrimination. What is the role of the market process in all this? Of course, the market process is where the competitive process, the competition actually happens. Okay, but is there any positive role at all for the market? And this is the basic claim, is that the initial ignorance of an economic process can be somehow being reduced during the market process. And coming back to the example of your friend that choose a supplier because of a certain discrimination, of a certain promise, and the supply is not able to keep on his promise, is because of the market process that he can realize, he can gather new information that this supply is not reliable and I have to look for someone else. So the market is, together with this essential instrument that we analyzed a few weeks ago, prices, the conveyor of information. It's where informations are acquired, are exchanged, and therefore the conflict nature of human purposes, of human plans, can in a way try to find a way to accommodate, where plans can become more mutual consistent each other because of the information transmissions that without market cannot happen. If we didn't have the market process, information via prices couldn't be communicated, and therefore that, and here I'm very careful when I choose my words. Ignorance is not reduced, it's modified. Indeed, we moved from a status of ignorance to another status of ignorance, in which, ignorance cannot be really quantified, cannot be weighed. But we can say that maybe we become more aware of certain things, but in the moment in which our level of ignorance is reduced on some aspect, can be increased on another aspect. So the content of information, which cannot be actually measured with metrics units, is always changing. Okay, but this changing process of information allow our plans to become more consistent. Okay? We communicate each other, we discover each other, and we find that we can work better in a certain way. And this makes our plans to match each other. And this is, again, a process that is mediated by prices, by institutions, we saw, but still remain, and with this we conclude, in a way, something miraculous. I already mentioned you the concept of spontaneous order, the outcome of human action but not human design. I give you already the example of traffic, the example of breakfast in the morning. All these things testify that the communication system, the communication process that happens in the market, in the competitive process, is a good vehicle of transmission for making our plans more consistent to each other. And this is actually happening. It should be for us as economists a great source of astonishment. We are surprised. And if we look at the outcome of market processes and the outcome of central planning, we must admit, without going into any concept of Platonic perfection, that the outcome of market processes is better than the outcome of central plans. Whenever there was a central plan, with all the good intentions, with all the attempt to bring ideal concept to society, we turn out to have hells. Market, with all its imperfections, with all its limits, brings a higher level of mutual coordination among human beings. This means that market is a heaven? No. We, as a free market advocates, are not trying to bring on earth any paradise, because every attempt to bring here a paradise is always the best way to bring here a hell, an inferno. Okay? Rather, we simply look at the best process bringing out the better outcome. The better possible outcome, for a certain moment probably, can be better, but the reality is testifying that the freer it is, the better it is.
How about in a certain situation, for example, if the barrier to entry is so high, for example, proton, yeah, initiated by the governments, and then they give a certain, it was supposed like 5 years protectionism act.
Yeah.
And then if that protectionism is not there, how do like they want to enter into this kind of market?
Okay. Look at the outcome of protected proton.
Because they abuse the protectionism.
Abuse. I mean, no, not all. But and this is, even Mahathir is writing this in the Doctor in the House. In the end, the outcome of protectionism is creating rent-seeking situations. Is making people more lazy because they don't have the incentive to fight in the market. So Proton was created because the Prime Minister was saying we, as a developing country, cannot avoid to have a national car producer. It's written somewhere. So we have to distinguish what is the need in the market and what is the projected plan of a single mind over the market. What the Prime Minister at the time was saying was something fascist in a way. You know, and here today I give free spirit to my philosophical nature. Already quoted you Plato, Aristotle, Popper. Now we introduce another one. The king of all the crazy once, okay, dead, sick, embracing his horse. Who knows? Embracing his horse, and then getting hurt by the horse and die.
It's okay to walk the horse.
Huh?
Why walk the horse?
Embracing. Friedrich
Hegel.
Ah! No, and you see, Hayek is dead embracing a horse.
No.
I heard the Friedrich Engels, which is not. Another Friedrich. Nietzsche!
Yeah.
Nietzsche, Friedrich Nietzsche era vegetariano. E scrisse molte lettere a Wagner. Friedrich Nietzsche. Impossible to write. Friedrich Nietzsche developed a concept which is at the nature of all the authoritarian government, even if he didn't know, the will of power. The will of power. Okay? So, when a prime minister comes to the arena and says, hey, we are strong, we must have our own car producer. Or it's like same like when Mussolini in the 20th was saying, hey, we are strong, we become autarchics. We don't need anybody else, we produce everything by ourselves. Okay? Nice. When you go in a square and you talk to people and say, you are strong, we can do everything by ourselves. Yes, we are strong, fuck everybody else. We can do, yes, bolela, yes we can. It's all the same story, eh? If you look at the history, nothing new under the sun. But where is the gripping point, the weak point of the will to power? That it can work at a personal level if you are looking at the development of a certain personal approach to life. Okay? So we can take, eventually, Friedrich Nietzsche as a personal master. It's very dangerous. I don't advise you to do so. You should be go through a certain process of purification first. But if you take it as a political master, then you are doing an abuse of his philosophy. Because the will of power, when we say we want to be a strong nation, and we want, which sounds good, but if you do it against reality, then you are a fool. Because nobody can go against reality. Because if Italy, now we have a lot of things, Italy, now we have to go out of the euros, because you see, euro make us poorer, and we will have a weaker currency, so we can export at better advantage. Yes. But do you have raw materials to build your own things? No. So you know that with a weaker currency, all your import will go up. So your cheaper products will be no more so cheap, because your import will become bloody expensive. So it's pain on television politically to say, yeah, go back to our currency. We are the king of our currencies. Make Italy strong again. But what are you not considering? Reality. And how can we actually better understand reality, looking at it, living it? So the freer is the society, the higher is the possibility for people operating every day in the reality to discover what is actually needed. So when we say, we need a national car producer. Are we actually listening at the market, or we are simply applying our will to power to reality? So are you being Aristotle or are you being Nietzsche? Aristotle lived a long life. Nietzsche died crazy embracing his horse. So let's choose who you want to be. And Aristotle was the personal teacher of Alexander the Great, by the way.
But it's not fair to only judge the proton case. They say we have Hyundai in
Korea,
South Korea. Hyundai get a lot of protection by the government, and so the government just initiate the Hyundai, even though they have lots of Japanese cars and also US. Even also from General Motors in US also get a lot of protection. When the Japanese want to enter the market, having cheaper cars, but they still put on lots of trade barriers to the Japanese. So, but all of them are, I mean, still going very well.
But in fact, I'm not telling that necessarily, I mean, when you have an idea, it's not necessarily a bad idea. Okay? But the fact is that reality prove if there is that need in the market for doing that. And there might be certain people that because of their personal ethics, even with protection, they work in a way to make things efficient. We have under the fascism, the government, the public industries, the government companies, they were profitable because of the moral rectitude of the people running these companies. But where is the wrong point? Is that if you are entrusting, if you are under a central plan, you are entrusting the possibility of success of your entrepreneurial action to the personal ethic of the people. So if you are lucky, you have a good human material, you succeed. If you are not and you are going against the market, then you are in a big mess. If instead you let the market to decide what is good and what is not, then you are never wrong, because an eventual bad entrepreneurial decision can be cut off before it's too late. If someone starts a certain company and find out that there is no market for that and is not able to do it in a way that the market, in a way in the competitive process is winning, must change something, change his plan or shut down his company and do something else. Okay? So if you do something as a governor, you might be lucky and get it right, but then you let your destiny to be decided by so many factors, and when you discover the decision is wrong, might be too late. Like with many government companies, what you do, like we have this case with Alitalia now, it should fail, it should simply close down, but we have 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, I don't know, 10,000 employees. What we do with these people? You create a big mess. If it was let the market to see and force this company to run into the competitive arena, then if it was not able to compete in the market before arriving and having 10,000 employees, maybe already shut down, or maybe could have started to do things in a better way, rather than hiring people for political reasons, should hire people because they are good in doing things, not because his family vote my political party. So the market is a better judge. This is the point. And a faster judge. So situation can change before it's too late, rather than central planning. But we will go into this in the module 2. So today we will close with let the market be Aristotelic rather a Platonic approach to socialism or a Nietzschean way to power.
But still, when you say central planning don't work, I think countries still need a certain framework to, you know,
framework
condition that we need to go there, or else that we did.
The issue is not not to have a plan, but who plan for who. Like Hayek was used to say, I prefer many to plan for themselves, to plan for many rather than few planning for many. So plan, everybody has a plan. We are all guided by plans. This is what I'm talking in the first lesson. But who is planning for who? This is the key. Plan is an essential part of the economic process. Without plans, we don't wake up in the morning.
Yeah. I mean, the people give the idea to the government, then the government create the plans by input, get input from the people, and from people to people.
The problem is not to get the ideas, because people, the problem is that in the market you can discover if your idea was a good idea or something has to be changed. If something is forcibly implemented by the government, you don't have the test if your idea is good or not. That is the main issue. So it's not the problem to gather ideas. The problem is that in the market, ideas can change. And if your idea was a stupid idea, you can find out and eventually change direction. If you have an idea, you believe it's good, government believe it's good, but in the end it was not, you are nurturing, you are making grow something wrong. And when it is discovered it was wrong, maybe it's too late for having, and you will have bad consequences for the economic system. So don't let government take care of the ideas of the people. Let people take care of their own ideas.
Because government failures affect more people compared to a private failure.
Because when an individual or a company is acting in the competitive arena, it is a test every day. And therefore, success or failure can be judged promptly in the action every day, and therefore the damage can eventually be corrected in time before it's too late. When government is, because it's government and has the power to protect things, it's like a father with a kid. You have the power to hold your child for many years because it's lighter than you. But what if you discover later that he didn't develop his legs? So when you finally decided to leave it, he's not able to walk. And you haven't discovered that maybe he had a problem in the legs and needed a special therapy for developing his legs. So let your child take ground every day. So if there is a problem, it can be detected and you can take an action plan. But if you are always lifting up from the floor, you will never discover if there are problems. I think the metaphor.
One last question. About perfect competitions and entrepreneur. If you can see the economy right now, there's a lot of blockchain going on,
yeah,
where they eliminate the middleman, which is the entrepreneur. So the clients or the customer right now is linked directly to the manufacturer, but then you're going to create a monopoly in the market.
We will talk about this next time. Because we will talk about who is the entrepreneur. Okay? I send you home earlier today? Because next week will be tough. In 2 weeks will be tough. Be prepared. It will be a long discussion.